What is your name, please?
My name is Ray Yeager.
My name is Ray Yeager.
My name is Ray Yeager.
Only one of these young people is the real Ray Yeager. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Peggy Cass, Orson Bean, and Kitty Carlisle on To Tell the Truth. To Tell the Truth is brought to you this evening by Anacin, the headache tablet to relieve pain, so relax tension, calm nerves. Anacin. And here, sitting in for vacationing Bud Collier, is our host, Robert Q. Lewis.
Thank you, thank you. Hi. Thank you very much. Thank you, Johnny Olson. Hello there, panel.
Hi.
Oh, you look gorgeous. We're going to get you tonight. Anyway, would you please open your first envelopes and follow along as I read, please. I, Ray Yeager, am a police officer. I'm also a fan of country and western music. Last year, just for fun, I made a guitar out of scrap wood and started writing songs. I've just recorded one of these songs, which has been picked by Variety, the Bible of show business, as one of the week's best releases. When I sing this song for you a little later in the program, it will mark my very first professional appearance anywhere. Signed, Ray Yeager. To my left, three folks, all claiming to be Ray Yeager. Peggy, would you start, please?
Yes, thank you. Miss Yeager, number one, what is that costume that you have on?
A policewoman's uniform.
From where?
Regional North Carolina.
Oh, thank you. Number three, what is Cashbox?
It's a record reviewing publication.
Thank you. And number two, who recorded your song? What record company recorded it?
Tiara.
Tiara. And number one, did you just do it by yourself, or what kind of a background did you have?
I had a group.
How many in the group?
Oh, about five or six.
Was it percussion?
I had drums, bass, steel guitar, and piano.
Number three, if this is going to be your first professional singing thing, weren't you nervous when you made your record?
Yes.
Thank you. Number...
Thank you, Peggy. Orson.
Number two, who is the Kansas City star?
That's Roger Miller.
Number one, what's the home of Grand Ole Opry? What city?
Nashville.
And number one, why are most of the good country and western things recorded in Nashville?
That's where the sound is.
What is the sound, number two?
Nobody can really explain it. It's just something that's there. You can't explain it.
Yeah. Number three, name three great country and western singers named Hank.
Hank Williams, Hank Snow.
Yeah. And Hank Bean, my uncle, from Winthrop, Massachusetts, not too well known outside of
Kitty Carlisle.
Number one, I'd like to find out about how you got interested in making your own guitar. What did you make it out of?
Oh, just pieces of wood I could find.
Number two, why didn't you buy one?
I couldn't afford it.
On a policeman's pay?
Not the kind I wanted. I want a deep sound. The only thing kind you can get is out of a good class guitar.
Number three, how much would a very good guitar cost?
More than I could afford.
How much?
Well, they range, starting about $12 up.
Well, what would be the most expensive one that you would like?
About $300.
Thank you. Number three, what kind of police
thank
work...
Thank you, Kitty. Tom.
Thank you, Bob. Number three, do you know Gene Autry's real name?
No, I don't.
I don't either, but I know he changed it. Number two, what is a come-along? What do you use that for as a cop, I mean, as a policeman?
Well, only to bring along somebody that's not willing.
Thank you. Number one, I'm very interested in the guitar. Who taught you how to make it?
Nobody.
Well?
Just figured it out for myself.
What did you use as a pattern, I guess?
Oh, other guitars.
Then you, number three, did you have another guitar?
I had the head of one.
Oh, my. Thank you.
Well, there you are, panel. My guy, time to vote. Without consultation or changing your ballots, please pick out, will you? Number one, number two, or number three. And, of course, as you know, folks, you get $250 for each incorrect vote. All right. Tomas, who do you think is the real guitar?
It could be any of them. Number one certainly sounds like a singer, and number three is cute as a button, but I'd vote for number two and love to hear him sing.
All right, Peggy.
Oh, I voted for number one because she said, because it's the sound. I mean, you know, though she really meant it.
And Orson.
Well, I think it has to be a girl, because if there was one fella named Ray, why would they get two girls? On the other hand, if there was a girl named Ray, they might get a fella and a girl. And I have a hunch it's number three. However, I got all confused and voted for number two.
And that's the kind of reasoning that's made this show what it is. All right, Kitty.
I voted for number one. It may well be number two, but I think number one had a kind of determination, and I think she may well be a policewoman.
Well, there are the votes. Now then, let's show you in this way. We'll give you a television first, ladies and gentlemen. The song that Variety picked as the hit of the week, Country Boy, an original composition played on a homemade guitar by our singing police officer, Ray Yeager. There it is. Get your guitar, Ray. All right, boy.
City slickers, don't put me down. I was born in the country, not in the town. I was raised in the hills without any shoes. My daddy sells homemade moonshine booze. I'm just a country boy, yeah, just a country boy. Well, I got stitches in my britches, cause they're just a pair of hand-me-down blue jeans. Got a guitar? What kind you got? A store-bought guitar? Ha! That ain't so hot. I made my own out of wood I could find, and it plays as good as any old kind. I'm just a country boy. Yeah, just a country boy. I ride a horse, of course. Ain't that the only way to get around? Country.
That's great, Ray. Thank you very much. Good luck to you in your career.
Thank you very much.
Matter of fact, keep the record straight. Ray is a patrolman on the police force of Pembroke Pines. That's down in Florida. Now then, number one, let's find out who you really are. You got yourself two votes.
I'm Sandy Bowman. I'm doing research for National Education Television and Radio Center.
And you lost your accent. Number three, you didn't get any votes, but you were most impressive. Let's find out who you are.
Thank you. Nancy Scores. I'm a registered nurse.
Okay. Well, as you see, there have been two incorrect votes, which means $500 for you all to share. It's been a lot of fun. Thanks so much for being with us, and good night. Now let's meet our next team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is Richard Roberts.
My name is Richard Roberts.
My name is Richard Roberts.
All right, panel, would you follow along as I read, please? I, Richard Roberts, am a professional highlight player. Highlight is generally conceded to be the fastest game in the world. The game is played indoors on a court 180 feet long. The ball, which is harder than a baseball, travels at speeds up to 150 miles an hour. Jai-alai is played mostly in Spain, France, and Latin America. And although its popularity is growing in this country, I'm the only jai-alai player born and raised in these United States. As a matter of fact, I'm the only player in the world from an English-speaking country. Signed, Richard Roberts. Three gentlemen to my left, they all claim to be a highlight expert named Richard Roberts. Kitty Carlisle, would you start, dear?
Thank you. Number one, what is the basket called that you're carrying?
It's a cesta.
Number two, what is the ball made of?
The ball is made of hard rubber and goatskin.
Number three, how many players on a team?
Well, on a team, two.
You play opposite one other player?
Two other players in doubles. Players.
Number one, where do you play in Florida?
Miami Highlight.
Number two, what's the name of the place called?
Miami Fronton.
Thank you. Number three, is there a great deal of betting on Jai-alai?
Yes, there is.
Number one, do you ever bet?
No,
play. Never bet on yourself. No. Number two, where did you learn this game?
West Palm Beach.
You learned to play there. Number three, who is the greatest jai-alai player in the world, aside from yourself, perhaps?
Chiruka, I guess.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kitty. Tom.
Well, I'm curious. I'll ask if I may. Number two, tell me how you start to play the game. Do you bounce the ball on the floor and then pick it up with your cesta, or do you have it in your hand or put it in the cesta? How does it actually start?
It is in the cesta, and you serve the ball off the forward wall.
Thank you. Number one, from how far back do you serve this? Which line marks the service line?
11. Approximately 11, which is approximately 80 feet back.
Well, all right. Thank you. Number seven, where does the ball have to carry
number
before...
Number seven?
I mean, he's got number seven on.
Oh, I beg your pardon. I'm sorry.
As a matter of fact... Why is his different?
I think I've cut you out of a question. Peggy?
Thank you. Number three, how many games a night are played in the Miami Fronton?
Number three?
How many games are played a night? How many teams play?
Oh, 11. I thought you said number three. I'm sorry.
No, 11. Thank you. Number three, what's a quinella?
It's a bet. The top two players.
Thank you. But how many, it's like a parlay. How many times do you get to bet on a game if you have one quinella? Oh, well, I was young when I was there. Tell me, number two, how many periods do they have in a game of jai-alai?
How many periods do they have in a game of jai-alai?
Yes.
There are no periods in a game of jai-alai.
Thank you, number one.
Thank you, Peggy. Time's up. Orson.
Number one, if I'm sitting in the stands and I want to make a bet on the game during the progress of the game, how can I do so?
They have female bookies, sir.
Female bookies?
Yes.
Well, female or male, how is the money passed around?
Through the girl. She'll come to you if you hold your hand up.
Number two, in Mexico City, there's a unique way of passing the money around. Do you happen to know what it is?
I've never played in Mexico City, sir.
Do you happen to know what it is anyway?
No, sir.
Then number three, do you know anything about this method of passing the money around?
Yes, they have red caps that run around and take the bets.
Uh-huh. Number one, where did you learn to play?
Miami.
And number one, again, what does it mean when they yell, have you ever played in a Spanish-speaking country?
No, I have not, sir.
Ah, all right. What does...
That's it. That's all the time we have. I'll ask you now, if you will, without consultation, to vote. And vote for jai-alai player number one, number two, or number three. And by golly, I think you're up against a couple of great imposters, huh?
Number two.
Pretty darn good. Everybody set? There's Kitty getting ready. Everybody set. Tom, how did you vote?
Well, in spite of the fact that number one certainly looks like he's been in the sun, and indeed he must have, and number three certainly looks like an athlete, I voted for number two because of his sure way of answering the question.
Okay. Peggy.
See, I voted for number two, and the reason is, if you play jai-alai, you must have a great big right arm. Because, boy, they really work at it. And he's got a shirt on to cover up his arm. So I think probably has a lot of muscles there.
All right. Orson?
Well, three didn't know exactly what a quinella was, and he also said that they have bellboys in Mexico City. You throw a rubber ball
in.
A rubber ball with a hole in it, and you stick the money in there, and they cry out, cinco cincuente or cinco rojo, and all things like that. Tune in next week, friends, to find out how a young man from New England...
You voted, I gather, for number two.
Yes.
All right.
Oh, dear.
Kitty?
Well, I voted for number three, but I thought it was number one, but I thought he knew how they bet in Mexico City, and I didn't, so I voted for number three.
Well, I don't know. There are the votes, and I must tell you, I don't know either. Just don't know. Let's find out now which of these fellas is Richard Roberts, the jai-alai player. Will the real Richard Roberts please stand up? Incidentally, Richard plays jai-alai at Tijuana, which is close to San Diego. I say that because I see it every once in a while. Congratulations. Hey, that's pretty darn good. Hey? All right, number one, let's find out who you really are, sir.
My name is John Henry Gottner. I'm a stuntman in motion pictures and television.
By I must say, number two, you really got him. You got three votes. Let's find out who you really are.
My name is Tom Stern. I'm advertising director of the Bergen News in Bergen County, New Jersey.
They'll never let you get over this. Well, by golly, three incorrect votes, gentlemen, which means a total of $750. We couldn't be happier. Thank you for being with us, and good night. And now let's meet our third team of challengers.
What is your name, please?
My name is Kenneth Wagman.
My name is Kenneth Wagman.
My name is Kenneth Wagman.
All right, gang, would you follow along as I read, please? I, Kenneth Wagman, am an animal scientist whose research has revealed that all cows are not contented cows. As a matter of fact, cows actually do a great deal of arguing and fighting, most of it at mealtimes. This causes bad feeding habits and a resultant loss of weight. Even the most placid cow is forced to engage in a series of butting contests to establish her social rank in the herd. And cows have other problems, panel. Sometimes they walk over 2 miles a day searching for food, water, and lost calves. They spend about an hour running away from heel flies. And despite all this activity, a cow, believe it or not, gets less than 1 hour sleep each day. Signed, Kenneth Wagman. Gentlemen, I welcome you, and I can think of only one way to start this questioning with a man on our panel who is an expert in your field, the eminent veteran, Mr. Orson Bean.
Ha, ha, thank you. Well, judging by the milk I get, I'm not surprised to hear all this good stuff. I'm from Vermont, number two, and I've always known that cows were soreheads. How long did it take you to find it out?
Well, it took me 5 years.
Yeah? Why did you go about such a study?
Well, we had started a study in supplementary feeding of range cattle,
yeah.
And we discovered that some of them weren't gaining the weight they should.
Yeah, and there's nothing worse than a skinny cow, is it? Number three, why do they spend all this time running away from heel flies? What are heel flies?
That's a particular nasty kind of fly that gets into the bloodstream and comes out, lays its eggs, and finally comes out through the skin.
Oh, that's more than I wanted to know, number three.
Thank you, Orson. Kitty.
Number one, why do these cows get no sleep?
Well, I don't know. Cows just don't seem to sleep very much.
Number two, do they close their eyes when they go to sleep?
Yes, they do.
That's how you know they're asleep?
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, they don't get any sleep. About the social rank, number three, what creates the leader of a cow herd?
Sheer nastiness, I guess, and determination.
You mean the worse temper the cow, the more she has in rank?
Yes, ma'am.
Number one, what happens to the ones that are sort of at the end of the line?
Well, they're at the end of the line when the feed bucket comes around.
Ah.
Thank you, Kitty. Now, another expert, Tom Poston.
Well, number two. what is a ruminant, number two?
Well, that's a type of animal that regurgitates its food to chew it.
Oh, boy.
Thank you. Number three is, what do you say to a cow to calm her down? Traditionally, when you want to work the cow for any reason, what do you say to it?
Well, on the range cows, you just don't.
You don't say nothing except, look out, here comes a cow. Number one, what would I say? I used to be a farm boy. What did I used to say to the cow to calm her down and get her to do what I wanted to do?
I don't know. You're talking about a milk cow or a range cow?
Yeah, a milk cow.
Well, we worked with range cows, but I suppose you'd talk to a cow just like you would yourself.
Thank you, sir. Now, Peggy Cass.
Thank you. Well, number two, do the nice milk cows, they're not like those range cows. They're sweet, right?
That's right.
Number three, is that where they got the name Bossy, because they're so mean?
No, that's part of their Latin name, I think.
Oh. Number one, what color is a Hereford?
A Hereford is red with white face and legs.
Thank you. Number three, could you tell me, what's a cud?
Oh, that's part of the grass that's been chewed in a real hurry and regurgitated and chewed again.
Oh, gee whiz, I'm glad I asked about that.
All right, panel, time for dinner. Time once again to vote, if you will, please. Would you mark your ballots now for gentleman number one, number two, or number three?
Oh.
And this again is a toughie, I think,
Oh, it is a toughie. They were too smart.
Oh, boy. All right, here we go. Are we all set? Tom, for whom did you vote?
I made a mistake. I voted for number one, but I certainly used to call so bossy. I've said that many times to the cow.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was traditional.
All right, Peggy.
Well, I voted for number three because anybody who knows the Latin, that bossy comes from the Latin name, that's got to be right, right?
Yes, I...
Orson.
I think they're all fine. It could have been any of them. I voted for number one, though.
I'm kidding.
I voted for number three because he said that they chewed up that grass real fast and then, well, you know what else he said.
All right, there are the votes. Let's find out now which of these gentlemen is the real Kenneth Wagman. Will the real Kenneth Wagman please stand up? Very good. Incidentally, may I point out, you may resume your take your seat again, Mr. Wagman. Mr. Wagman, is it Mr. or Doctor?
Mr.
Mr. Wagman is a specialist in animal husbandry at the University of California, and that's at Davis.
Right.
And that must be fascinating work.
It is.
Yeah, the miserable cows you have to deal with there. Well, it's been a lot of fun. Thank you, sir. Number two, you were most convincing. Let's find out who you really are, sir.
Well, I'm Gene Tway. I'm vice president of Empire Crafts Corporation. We sell silver in China.
And number three, you were delightful. You also got two votes. Let's find out who you are, sir.
My name is Tom Gillette, and I handle the advertising for the Allegheny Power System.
I think you'll have to agree with me. We had some darn good imposters tonight, these gentlemen included. Well, by golly, let's see. Two incorrect votes, and that's not bad at all. $500, gentlemen. We hope you enjoy sharing it. We've certainly enjoyed having you here tonight. Thank you so much. Good night. Well, I must say, that winds up our time for tonight. I haven't enjoyed anything as much in a long time. I know Bud will be back with you all next Monday night, but I want to thank this panel for giving me 3 weeks of great enjoyment. Thank you.
Bob, when are you going to start making the film of How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying?
It's nice. We go into rehearsal on April the 4th, and then we start making it around the 1st of May.
Good.
I think that'll be fun, too.
Good luck with it.
Thank you. And,
good luck.
You know, again, thank you so much. Thank you all. And Bud will be back with you next Monday night at the same time. I'll be on for the remainder of the week on daytime. Meanwhile, this is Robert Q for Bud Collier, reminding you, as Bud always does, to tell the truth.
To Tell the Truth is a Mark Goodson, Bill Todman production. To Tell the Truth has been brought to you by Dristan Nasal Mist, the decongestant nasal spray that gives you deep relief from sinus congestion and head cold distress. Dristan Nasal Mist. Johnny Olson speaking. This program was pre-recorded.